Postmodernism is a narrative theory that is meant to be vague as to depend on the person's insights and interpretation of the individual narratologist. It rejects hierarchy and the separation of levels, and is yet still tempting to use as a conceptual framework for a highly structured fiction, such as video games. Hello, my name is Kyle Boddy, and the following is my presentation for CIM 211 Project 1 for SAE Perth. Today I'll be looking at 2007's Bioshock by 2K Games, with reference to its ideas on politics, religions, ethics, and objectivism through a postmodern lens. Video games and postmodernism go hand in hand, as the rise of postmodernism is tied so strongly to the rise of technology. These days, most people access postmodern media through streaming services, be it in the home or direct to mobile devices. Games are a relatively new form of media. They offer a way to twist and turn the relationship between author and audience in a way no other mediums can offer. Released in 2007 to both critical and commercial success, being not only an action blockbuster, but also a self-referential commentary on video games as a whole, deliberately deconstructing the traditional myth of interactivity and choice that is suggested within the medium. You are not playing the game is playing with you. The game takes place in a parallel 1960s universe in the underwater city of Rapture, conceived by former socialist businessman Andrew Ryan, as a means to escape the increasingly oppressive political, economic, and religious authorities he had faced on the surface. The antagonist Andrew Ryan's name is an anagram of We Are Ayn Rand, Ayn Rand, a famous female author and creator of the objectivism philosophy. The duo's beliefs mirror each other as well. Ayn Rand, a Russian-born American writer whose commercially successful novels promoting individualism and laissez-faire capitalism, the idea that a good government only exists to protect individual rights and stay out of people's personal lives and the market. Ryan's looming bust gazes down on you as you arrive in Rapture. A banner sports the slogan, "No gods or kings, only man." As the story of Bioshock progresses, it becomes painstakingly clear that much of what happened to Rapture was due to the chaos resulting from Ryan's ideals. However, this giant golden bust suggests that Andrew Ryan sees himself as a king, and throughout Rapture, as we learn of Ryan's philosophy on the chains of industry, that he places them in a godlike position, forcing the people of Rapture to follow them in an almost cult-like fashion. These ideals were influential among conservatives and libertarians, and popular among generations of young people in the United States from the mid-20th century. Who is John Galt? Is a cryptic question posed in Atlas Shrugged, Ayn Rand's self-proclaimed magnum opus, her fourth and final novel released in 1957. A similar question is posed throughout Rapture, asking who is Atlas? Atlas being the narrator and guiding voice for the player throughout the game. The city of Rapture itself was built purely as a place to practice objectivism. The inhabitants are all able individuals primed for success and discovery. Without the interference of government or people concerned with the greater good, Ryan created a place where he thought the elite could flourish. The first time we hear Andrew Ryan's voice, it is a pre-recorded message.
I am Andrew Ryan, and I'm here to ask you a question. Is a man not entitled to the sweat of his brow? No, says the man in Washington, it belongs to the poor. No, says the man in the Vatican, it belongs to God. No, says the man in Moscow, it belongs to everyone. I rejected those answers. Instead, I chose something different. I chose the impossible. I chose Rapture.
All the chaos of a collapsing city, Atlas's assuring voice guides you along. Games have conditioned us to automatically trust what is being told, so long as it advances toward the end. Like Ryan, we are blind to outside influence. When it's finally revealed by Ryan that we have been brainwashed, it's too late to react. Atlas has a hold on us. Only then do we regret the habits that decades of video games have instilled on us, accepting anything that progresses the narrative as truth. Using both a postmodern and post-structuralist lens, we are able to see the many historical and religious references throughout the game. The level name Arcadia was inspired by the Latin phrase et in Arcadia ego, which translates to even in Arcadia I exist. The level is associated with bountiful natural splendor and harmony, so the phrase is a reminder that even in paradise, death exists. The tombstones in Arcadia each state that two persons are interred there. One epitaph reads, John Maynard Keynes, son of Adam and Ada Smith. This references two British economists, John Maynard Keynes and Adam Smith. Smith originated the ideas of free market capitalism and limited government intervention in the economy, while Keynes took the position that the government intervention was necessary to head off market failures. The Rosie version of Big Daddy is a reference to the cultural icon Rosie the Riveter, who represented working women during World War II. Rosies in Bioshock also carry a rivet gun as a weapon. The Gatherers Guarding Vending Machines advertising slogan mentions both Einstein and Hercules.
My daddy's smarter than Einstein, stronger than Hercules, and lights a fire with a snap of his finger.
Albert Einstein was a theoretical physicist who developed the general theory of relativity, one of the two pillars of modern physics, and Hercules is a hero in Roman mythology known for his great strength. The city's name Rapture is a Christian term referring to an event that removes the chosen people in the world from society and transports them to a paradise. To make the Lazarus vector, Jack needs 7 distilled water, 7 enzyme samples, and 7 chlorophyll solution. The number 7 is used frequently in the Bible, over 700 times in fact, and the name Lazarus itself comes from the biblical story of a man named Lazarus who is raised from the dead by Jesus. In the game, the Lazarus vector raises Arcadia from death. In the introduction slideshow to Rapture, Andrew Ryan says, "And with the sweat of the brow, Rapture can become your city as well." The phrase sweat of your brow is taken from Genesis 3:19, in which God tells Adam that outside of the Garden of Eden, only by the sweat of thy brow will you be able to raise food to survive. When Ryan contacts Jack early on in Rapture's central control, he references the Bible, saying, "Even in a book of lies, you can still find some truth." He then quotes the part he calls the truth, Ecclesiastes 3:1, "To everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven." He also uses the early portions of Ecclesiastes 3 as a model to explain trying to destroy Rapture when he says, "A time to build and a time to destroy." If the player saved the Little Sisters during their playthrough, Bridget Tenenbaum will express her gratitude in the elevator to Frank Fontaine's penthouse by saying, "To save one life is to save the entire world." This is a Jewish saying from the Talmud. The actual quote reads, "Whoever destroys a soul is considered as if he had destroyed the entire world. Whoever saves a life is considered as if he has saved an entire world." One of the most essential dilemmas in Bioshock is choice and free will. In the game, Andrew Ryan reminds us, we all make choices, but in the end, our choices make us. With this, we believe that if we make choices, we are free. However, if our choices make us, how can we be free to make them? This conundrum leads us to the question, is free will possible? One school of thought known as hard determinist suggests that there is no such thing as free will. If all actions can be boiled down to cause and effect, then all of our actions are always bound by an external force. Andrew Ryan reiterates this in the most brilliant part of the game with the phrase, "A man chooses, a slave obeys." This is a statement on the nature of the game itself, as how you, the player, are destined to mindlessly follow the fixed path of the game's narrative, and any interactivity or idea of choice that will change how the said narrative is played out is a lie. There are books about books and films about films. Bioshock is exactly this. It's a game about games. It uses postmodernism to deconstruct the fixed binaries of video games as a medium. The previous narratological application is just a brief example of what we can do with narratological language and structures in order to understand a textual form represented by a piece of software set up to organize different textualities and regulate the freedom of its interactors. Narrative elements in games are constructed in different order that admits the player to different levels of fictional communication, allowing him or her to express and influence the fictional world, and yet these narratives are highly structured. Through its philosophical narrative, characters, dialogue, and plot twists, Bioshock consistently questions freedom, or more accurately, what defines freedom, the binaries of free or slave, or perhaps somewhere in between. Thank you for listening. Now applaud, would you kindly?